Well, good morning. Do grab a seat, folks. We're going to start any second. I hope you like my mask. A crazy friend of mine sent it to me. I don't actually need to wear it, but there we are. Happy Easter. Now, under normal circumstances, at the start of our Easter family service, I would say to you, Christ is risen, and you would say, oh, well, there you go. I could hear you through your masks. So welcome to everyone who's joined us on the live stream or via Zoom. This is our Easter service at Bethany. And the opportunity, if you're accessing on YouTube, to leave comments, please do. We've had one or two comments passed on to us. Mandy thanks us for our love and prayers as a fellowship. And I would mention at this point that Brenda needs our prayers, particularly this morning. So please remember Brenda in your prayers. I've got a very busy program, nothing new with things I put together. There'll be an interactive section where you've got bits of paper on your chairs, then pens. They've all been nicely sanitized, etc., and laid out in advance and what have you. And as you leave later on, you will see we've got a number of socially distancing eggs over here that you will be able to help yourself to. And they're hollow eggs to remind us that the tomb is empty. If you're working on the craft tables, opportunity to do Easter cards, or maybe an Easter mosaic, so there's a pile of tissue paper there, you can rip it up, glue it on, make something, perhaps not a slug this time, but something that reminds us of Easter would be good. And we'll have a look at those later on. But before we go any further, let's spend a moment or two in prayer. So, Father God, we thank you that we can meet together on this glorious, sunny Easter morning and remind ourselves that there was good news, that when the women went to the tomb, it wasn't full of a dead body, but it was empty because the Lord Jesus had risen from the dead and all of eternity was changed forever because of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be with us as we meet together and share together this morning. We remember particularly those in our prayers who can't be with us in the building. And we think of Brenda particularly this morning and ask that you would be with her. But Father, we thank you that we can be assured that you are here with us. And we pray there'll be a real sense of your presence here and joy at meeting together on this Easter Sunday. In Jesus' name, amen. At this point, we're going to listen to our first hymn, Thine Be the Glory. It's a lovely Easter hymn. And I remind you that though you can't sing out loud, you can sort of mumble away behind your mask. So please do that. And Tim will play that for us. Thine Be the Glory, Risen Conquering Son. I'm going to play it. Right. Right, time to spot the difference. So having a look at those screens, anyone like to tell me what's the difference? It's Good Friday, Easter Sunday, we're comparing the two. We zoomed together on Good Friday and we thought about the events of Good Friday, and today we're thinking about the events of Easter Sunday. So those two pictures, what does the first one represent? Anyone like to shout out what they think it represents? Sadness. Well, you're one screen too early. So you're going to get it right next time round, definitely. But it could be sadness, couldn't it? It could be. Yep. Pain. It could be pain. That isn't what I'm thinking about.
Despair
was what I was actually thinking about. I put that into Google and this is what came out, but it could be any of those things, couldn't it? All of those things relate to what's happening on Good Friday. So if despair is what people experience on Good Friday, what are they experiencing on Easter Sunday from that picture there? Hope. Yes, thank you. Hope. So we already know sadness for the first one there. It's a very sad-looking egg, and if you were about to bash its head in and eat it, you would be sad as well. So it's a sad egg. What have we got on Easter Sunday instead of sadness?
Revelation
and joy and all that kind of thing. And what have we got for Good Friday on that one?
Death.
Yeah, we've got a death mask. So Easter Sunday is meant to be a picture of life, okay, fair dues. If you don't get this one right, you better leave the church now, I think, at this point. So Good Friday is all about crucifixion, isn't it? And Easter Sunday is about resurrection. That's what we're going to think about this morning. So at this point, it wouldn't be a service at Bethany, would it, these days, without a Saddleback Kids version of a story. So we're going to look at part of the Easter story that relates particularly to resurrection at this point. Do I have to play this one as well, Tim? Yeah, okay, here we go.
Stories of the Bible. God is with us. This is Jesus.
Hey-o!
Jesus is the Savior of the world and the Son of God. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He healed many people from their sickness, performed many miracles, like calming storms, and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
But some people did not like what Jesus was doing. And they put him to death. He died on a cross and was buried in a tomb. For 3 days, Jesus' body laid in that tomb, and it seemed that there was no hope. But very early on Sunday morning, the woman who cared for Jesus went to go visit his body, found that his tomb was empty and that he was no longer there. For he was risen, he was alive.
Woo-hoo! Huh? Hey-o!
Rah! And then for the next 40 days, Jesus appeared to his disciples and many others and showed them that he was alive and well. He taught them that what he did was the only way that they could be forgiven and be with God forever. Jesus told his disciples that he did all the things that God had told everyone that he would do, and the disciples understood what he was saying.
Yep, that makes sense.
He told them that he would send the Holy Spirit, just as God had promised to be their helper.
Sounds good.
Okay. Now, this is my all-time favorite funny question. You can tell what kind of sense of humor I've got when you look at this. What if the hokey-cokey is what it's all about? And I've seen that on a number of boards and things you can put in your house. And I find that really, really funny. What if the hokey-cokey really is what it's all about? And it's only funny because clearly it's not what it's all about. If life was all about the hokey-cokey, that wouldn't be funny. That would be incredibly sad. But somebody somewhere has had a moment where they've asked the question, what if the hokey-cokey really is what it's all about? So another first here for Bethany. We are going to do the hokey-cokey together on Easter Sunday. We're not going to do all of it, obviously, and you are socially distanced, so you're okay. A big fan of the hokey-cokey is Prince Charles, as you can see from the screen there. and he's putting his left arm in and his left arm out. So I've got actually got a right hand here, but I'm going to pretend it's my left hand, and I'll do it. You can either join in or not join in. Nobody will see you, so you're all right. But we'll just try this at the moment. So you put your left arm in, your left arm out, in, out, in, out, shake it all about. You do the hokey-cokey and you turn around. That's what it's all about. Whoa, the hokey-cokey. Whoa, the hokey-cokey. Whoa, the hokey-cokey. Knees bent, arm stretch, rah, rah, rah. And that's as much as you're getting. I'm sorry, you can't go through the whole thing. But I really felt that we should do that this morning. We've never, ever done it on Easter Sunday morning at Bethany, and so I felt we should do the hokey-cokey. That's what it's all about. Well, incredibly sad if it was what it was all about. But we get a little bit confused too, don't we, about what Easter's all about. We can be drawn into thinking it's all about rabbits and chickens and eggs, and as I say, there will be an egg for you. Well, I hope the first 47 of you leaving will get one. If you're at the back, you might not. I've got an egg here. This one didn't pass quality control. It came in the bag half. So nice. Half broken. I don't quite know why. I must speak to Sainsbury's about that. But I'll eat the rest of that later. We're going to watch, at this point, another short clip. And this asks the question, Easter, what's it all about? Clearly, it's not about the hokey-cokey. Let's find out what Easter's all about and see if we can perhaps stop confusing ourselves about what Easter's about and find out the real meaning of Easter. So here we go.
What do you think Easter is all about? I think of chocolatey Easter eggs, lambs jumping, life of Brian, and lovely bunnies. Hot cross buns to the bloody scene of the crucifixion, and cute chicks to an empty grave. Jesus was killed, buried, and resurrected on the third day. He came back to life, resurrected. Christmas seems easier to believe than Easter. It's just a myth, right? A myth wouldn't stand up in a court of law. Not enough evidence. But what if I told you that Jesus' resurrection could? I invite you to review the evidence. Jesus really did die. The Romans were expert executioners. The spear through Jesus' side produced water and blood, something that only happens when the red blood cells separate from the plasma after it stops circulating around the body. The tomb was really empty. If Jesus' body was still in the tomb when the disciples began telling people of his resurrection, then it wouldn't have taken long for either the Jewish leaders or the Romans to wheel it out and completely dismantle the claims of the early church. Jesus really was seen alive after his crucifixion. Eyewitnesses testify to eating, walking, and talking with Jesus after his death. Around 500 people said that they saw him at one time. The accounts are reliable. The Gospels are eyewitness accounts written within the lifetime of those who spent time with Jesus before his death. Any discrepancies with the truth would have immediately been picked up by other eyewitnesses around at the time. Had Jesus not been resurrected, there's no way to explain the explosive rise of the Christian church in the first century AD. They had no state power. They didn't spread their ideas through violence. They had no enormous advertising campaign. Only something so extraordinary as the resurrection of Jesus could have spurred on such growth. So what do you think? Compelling evidence? Don't take my word for it. Look, discover, and decide from the source material. Review the evidence and see for yourself.
This morning we're going to do a little bit of Bible detecting. So I've brought my hat and my magnifying glass. I can't see a thing now through two sets of glasses. A little bit later, I'm going to invite you to do some work. There's bits of paper on the thing. But for the moment, I'll do a little bit of detective work with you. So can we trust the Gospels? Because what I'm going to share with you this morning is based on what we find in the Bible, in the Gospels. Can we trust the Gospels? If you've ever been to an Alpha course, you would have been faced with a chart similar to this, in which manuscript evidence for ancient writings compares very favorably for what we find with regard to the Bible, as compared to other things. So, for example, up there mentioned Caesar's Gallic Wars. The earliest, it was written between 100 and 44 BC, but the earliest copy is 900 AD, so it's 1,000 years, and there's only 10 copies. And then it mentions Plato, and it mentions Thucydides, Peloponnesian War. Here's my copy of the Peloponnesian War. It looks a little bit new and unopened, and that could be because I haven't read it yet. But it's a very thick volume, and it is on the shelf there for reading. And each time you find that there's a big gap between the date when it was written and the earliest manuscripts, and very few copies of it. The best attested early ancient manuscripts are for Homer's Iliad. There's about 600 of those. But when you come to the New Testament, which is written between 40 and 100 AD, the earliest copy is found about 125 AD, and it's only 25 to 50 years after these texts were being written. And we don't just have 10 manuscripts of it, or 7, or 8, or even 600, as we do for Homer's Iliad. We've got 24,000 manuscripts. So there's a lot of evidence to believe that the Bible, which we read today, is what it was as it was written. And on the screen at the moment, Josh McDowell, who at one point was a lawyer, and he was looking at the evidence, and he came and he said, you know, there's a lot of evidence there to prove that this is true. And it talks about 95% of what you find in the Bible. The scholars all agree it's absolutely spot on. In fact, they take it up to 97%, and then they go on to say, and any discrepancies, half of the discrepancies they find in the text, they're really just spellings or misspellings, or someone's copied it incorrectly. So scholars reckon about 98% of the Bible is actually spot on, and they work their way through the discrepancies. So you're not dealing with something that's, that wouldn't stand up, as it were, in a court of law. You're dealing with real evidence here today. So is the Bible reliable? Well, let's have a look at some alleged problems surrounding Jesus' resurrection. Good to ask these questions: where, who, how, what, when, why. And we take it all the way back to Kipling. Kipling said, "I keep 6 honest serving men. They taught me all I knew. Their names are what and why and when and how and where and who. I send them over land and sea. I send them east and west. But after they have worked for me, I give them all a rest. I let them rest from 9 till 5, for they are busy then, as well as breakfast, lunch and tea. For they are hungry men. But different folk have different views. I know a person small. She keeps 10 million serving men who get no rest at all. She sends them abroad on her own affairs. From the second she opens her eyes, 1 million hows, 2 million wheres, and 7 million whys." And anyone who's ever been a parent and had a young child will know they've been asked the question, why? 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 And maybe they're still asking those questions, and that's what that poem's about. That really, in a sense, as we get older, we lose our sense of wonder, we lose our desire to actually explore. So this morning, we're going to do a little bit of exploring. A lot of the information I'm going to share with you here is from a book called Easter Enigma. I've got a copy here. Goes back to 2005 by John Wenham. A lot of people say, well, if you read the gospel accounts, the 4 different versions of the resurrection, you can't reconcile them. There's so many differences. But Wenham has done a fabulous job in reconciling them and actually putting together a clear picture of the way the events pan out. So I'm going to very quickly just share 1 or 2 bits here with you. Who's involved in these accounts here? And don't forget, later on, you're going to be doing a little bit of work yourself. So we've got Mary Magdalene. Now, he argues quite strongly that Mary Magdalene and Mary of Bethany are the same person. That might come to you as a shock. You know, Martha's sister Mary is the same person as Mary Magdalene. But the church held that view from the 6th century up to the 19th century. It's only fallen out of belief in recent years. The church believed for many years that Mary Magdalene and Mary of Bethany were the same person. Even if they're not, it doesn't actually affect the events, but that's what Wenham goes with. And then he says, well, we hear about a woman called Salome in Mark, but in John we're told that it's Jesus' mother's sister. And in the book of Matthew, we find that this person is also the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee. And thirdly, in connection to the women, another person called Mary, she's the mother of James and Joseph in Matthew and Mark, but she's the wife of Clopas or Cleopas in John's version. Where's this all taking place? Well, Wenham, when he looks at this in detail, says at John's house, and John's got a big house in Jerusalem, we would find Peter, Mary Magdalene, Mary the wife of Clopas, Jesus' mother Mary, Salome, Zebedee, and Clopas. Every time I hear Zebedee, I think of a creature on the spring bouncing around the magic roundabout, but it's not that one. It's the father of James and John. At Bethany, about 2 miles away, the other disciples have run there. At the Hasmonean Palace, serving Herod are Joanna and Susanna. And on the Sabbath eve, Mary Magdalene, Clopas and Mary travel back from John's house after the crucifixion and go back to Bethany. How did he get all this information? How did the gospel writers get the information? Well, he argues that Matthew spoke to the Galilean women, that Mark got his information from Peter and Mary Magdalene, that Luke got it from Joanna and Cleopas, and John got it from John himself and also Mary Magdalene. And you have to read the book in detail to find out how this is all argued out. But at this point, we're going to take a quick break before we look at a little bit more information. And we've got a children's version of the Easter story, but told as a poem. So let's have a listen to that.
And then, just 3 days later, Mary went to see the tomb. Just before the sun rose in the early morning gloom, to cover Jesus' body with spices and perfume and honor Jesus, her dead friend. But when her journey ended and Mary had arrived, she found the stone was rolled away, the tomb was open wide. What happened here, she wondered, but she dared not go inside. Where is Jesus? My dear friend. So Mary went to Peter and told him what she'd seen. Then John and Peter went and looked, and where their friend had been lay nothing but his burial cloths, neat and folded clean. No sign of Jesus. Their dear friend. Then Mary went back to the tomb, and when she looked inside, she saw two angels sitting there, shining bright and white. She asked, "Where have you taken him? Please tell me now," she cried. Jesus, my dead friend. "Why are you weeping, woman?" a voice asked soft and kind. Mary turned and thought she saw the gardener behind. But when he said her name, she knew he was nothing of the kind. He was Jesus, her somehow living friend. "Go tell my friends," he told her. "Tell them all that I'm alive, not for now, but forever. I will never, ever die." So Mary went to Peter and the others and she cried, "I've seen Jesus, our forever living friend." Then Jesus came into the room, although the door was locked. His friends all thought he was a ghost. They trembled there in shock. "Don't be afraid," said Jesus. "Here, look at the nail marks. It's me. Jesus, your forever living friend."
At this point, we're going to hear the first of three readings. David Suchet is going to do the readings for us. And at some point, we're going to examine these three readings. That's where the Bible detective work comes in. You will have to do a little bit of work there. So this is John chapter 20, and it's the first 10 verses. And we'll listen to it as David Suchet reads it to us.
John chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying.
Now, before I ask you to do a little bit of work yourselves, let's ask the question, when is all this taking place? From that reading there. Well, it says early morning, doesn't it? It says early morning. Mary Magdalene and Mary go to the tomb from Bethany. We read about that in Matthew. And they go via John's house. So they come from Bethany, which is 2 miles outside the city. They go to John's house in the city. They pick up Salome there. Secondly, Mary Magdalene rushes from the tomb to tell Peter. So obviously, the other women are still there. Joanna and Susanna arrive at the tomb. Now, that's not in Scripture, but that's inferred because we find that later that they're at the tomb. So we don't get a reading of them coming, but they've got to be there because we're told so in Scripture. Then the women go into the tomb and they see a young man who's an angel. The women go off to tell the disciples, and Mark says, and nobody else but the disciples. And Peter and John run to the tomb and return home. So you've got there a harmony, if you like, an overview of putting the different versions of the gospel accounts together so that it actually makes sense. Who? Well, I wrote a poem about this a while ago. You see, Mary keeps turning up all the time. When I was growing up, there were loads of people called Alan because it was a very popular name. Nowadays, don't get so many Alans. Dropped out of favour. It was a classic name, but it's a bit like classic cars. They tend to be kept in garages, I think. But it was a classic name, Alan. Now, in the Bible times, Mary was a classic name. Everybody, every second person you came across who was a woman was called Mary. So I asked the question, Mary, Mary, it's quite scary. I don't know my Mary Martha from my Mary of Magdala or my Mother Mary from the other Mary at the cross. Can't you see I'm at a loss? And when you toss Roman Mary in with Barney's aunt, Mark's own dear mother, you can see why I'm in such a pother when the Bible mentions Mary, Mary, it's quite scary. I don't know my Mary Martha from my Mary of Magdala or my Mother Mary from the other Mary at the cross. Can't you see I'm at a loss? And when you toss Roman Mary in with Barney's aunt, Mark's own dear mother, you can see why I'm in such a pother when the Bible mentions Mary, Mary, it's quite scary. I could go on and on and on, couldn't I? But the Bible suggests there's at least 6, if not 7 different people called Mary. And so it's hardly surprising you get those Bible versions of the story of who's at the tomb, and you think, well, who is it, Mary? Was it Mary? Was it Mother Mary? Or was it Mary Magdalene? Or was it Mary? Very confusing. Very, very confusing. How? Now, at this point, you need to put your thinking caps on. I'll put my hat back on again. Hope you like this. Yeah, go dancing in this quite often, really. No, it used to belong to my niece. You need to pick up those pieces of paper you've got in front of you. You're only going to have 5 minutes on this, and because obviously we're streaming this live as well, we're not going to have a 5 minute hiatus. I'm going to do some talking. You can either listen to me or you can ignore me. But you need to have that first one in front of you, which says the John 20 version, and the first 10 verses. And the question at the moment, how do we know that Mary Magdalene did not go initially on her own to the tomb? And for those listening on Zoom or for those following this on live stream, what we read is as follows. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him. So, first question, okay, I've read that through to you, and you've had it in front of you. How do we know that Mary did not go to the tomb on her own? It says we. She's not Queen Victoria or someone else using the royal we. We don't know where they... So just because she's mentioned on her own doesn't mean that there weren't other people there. There's circumstantial evidence. I don't know whether Simon would get away with this or Andy would with circumstantial evidence in court, but it's dark. The time is about somewhere between about 3 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the morning. What self-respecting woman goes out at 3 o'clock in the morning in the dark? So circumstantially, you would expect her to go with us. She'd be frightened to be out there. And then you've got some extra evidence. So you should have another piece of paper. If you lift it up, you'll see some further evidence there, another extract from the Bible. Perhaps you'd just like to shout out the names of some of the other people who were mentioned there. What passage have you got there?
Mark.
Okay, and what does it tell you? Which people are there?
Salome.
Who?
Salome.
Yeah, I love Salome. I have it on pizza all the time. It's a very, very... Salome, anybody else? Mary, the mother of James. So when we did that little bit of harmonising earlier on, I'm saying to you, there's evidence. Right, now then, let's move it on. Let's ask a second question. Okay, what? This is a what question. So the question is, what do we deduce from the statement that the other disciple ran faster than Peter? And again, for the people who are listening on Zoom, I'll read it out. So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. So what are you deducing from those verses, the statement that the other disciple ran faster than Peter? The other disciple is probably John. So if we call him John, it will help, won't it? So what do we deduce from the fact that John runs faster than Peter? It's not in the passage. What did you deduce?
He's
younger, okay. That's one possibility.
Fitter.
He's fitter. That's two. Come on, detectives.
They,
well, yeah, yeah, they start the same place, but John gets there first. But what else?
Was Peter maybe a bit afraid because of the denial?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe he started running and thinking, I'm not sure if I really want to go there. And John overtakes him. You could come up with almost anything. You could say he was a better runner, he had better technique and all the rest of it. But as Ruth said, Peter was perhaps less keen to get there. Don't you find it odd that that's in the Bible? What a weird thing. They're not writing a novel. This is the kind of detail you'd find in a modern novel. Why put it in if it didn't really happen? It's weird, isn't it? When you read closely, you find all these clues to show that these are real eyewitness accounts. Let's move on. Let's ask one further question. Again, it's a what question. So... third question before we move on. In verses 5 to 8, which I'll read to you in a moment, the question is going to be, what can the other disciple not see by staying outside the tomb? So what can John not see by staying outside the tomb? And having entered the tomb, what does John deduce from the position of the grave clothes? And for those listening, we're looking at verses 5 to 8. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but didn't go in. Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. He saw and believed. So, I'm having a good look at you. See if you're still awake. Yes, you're still awake. Good, good. So, what... can the other disciple not see? What can John not see by staying outside the tomb? He would struggle to do that, but he can see some things, can't he? He can actually see certain things. You know, he bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but didn't go in. So he can see the strips of linen. So he could deduce maybe that Jesus had risen from that, but he's missing some other evidence. What is it?
His
Yeah. It's what was on his head. He's not able to see that because he can't sort of see round the corner. He's missing that. The chances are that unless we read the scriptures carefully for ourselves, we'll miss all kinds of details. And if we're the kind of people who've been listening to half-baked stories from other people and hearsay and things like that, and they were a good band as well, you will only get half the story. No lawyer worth his or her salt would just do a cursory examination and throw a few things in. They look really carefully at the evidence. So he can't see the cloth. And when he goes in, what can he see? What can he deduce from the grave clothes? Because in the Greek it says they were still in their folds, folded up or twisted, twirled around is the word there. What does he deduce? Well, yeah, but he's not there, is he? He's not there. So what does John believe? What does John believe seeing these empty grave clothes? Come on, detectives, or you're getting the sack. He's risen from the dead. Hallelujah. I said that with feeling. All right. Well, you can take your detective's hats off for a moment, and we're going to listen to another piece. This is a version of See What a Morning, and it's a very, very lively, rousing version. So again, you can mumble away under your masks as we sing See What a Morning. Definitely had their Weetabix for breakfast, didn't they? Fantastic. We're now going to hear another reading. So here's the second part of the evidence. So detectives, listen very carefully. It's the bit where Mary comes back to the tomb, verses 11 to 18 of John 20. You can follow it on the paper you've got in front of you. But again, we're listening to David Suchet.
Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her.
Let's ask another when question, all right? We'll ask a when question. Before we research this, and I ask you to look closely at the text together, we'll ask the question when. Remember, I'm talking about harmonizing, that is, making all the accounts agree, dovetail with each other, if you prefer. And so we looked at the first six events, early morning. Now we're moving on to morning itself. And this is what we find, that Mary Magdalene returns to the tomb. We read about that, and we've just read about that from John 20, verse 11 to 18. Salome and Mary, the wife of Clopas, set off for Bethany to tell the disciples, and Jesus meets them en route on their way. That's Matthew 28. Because when you look at these, they think, oh, nobody's telling the same story, but Wenham does a wonderful job of harmonizing them together. As a poem, I've read it to you before, this is my take on Mary coming to the tomb, such a momentous occasion, and what was happening there at the tomb. So Mary comes down to the tomb, but to her it feels more like an inverted womb, swallowing life after death with no expectation of breathing, of breath. And beyond hope, beyond contradiction, no sword forbidding, no stone interdiction, fighting back fear, holding at bay her heart's fibrillation, she hears them say, "Why look for the living here with the dead? He has risen. Go tell them." "That's what I said." Two young men. Too young to be men, too white to be anything else than angels, too bright. And weeping, coming across an altogether other one, thinking him the gardener, finding him the true vine, "Do not hold on. I have not yet ascended. This is all new. I go to my Father, my God, yours too." Mary returns, first witness to the risen Christ. An empty tomb, womb of the second birth, born the price. Death swallowed whole in life, digested, disgorged, destroyed. All of eternity impregnated, reinvested, reforged. Everything changes because there is an empty tomb. Now let's ask the question, what? And we're back to being Bible detectives again. I hope you brought your hats this morning. I'm looking at, yes, thank you. Thank you for bringing those hats with you this morning. And I want you to look again at John 20. You've got the bit of paper there in front of you, verses 11 to 30, and I'm going to read that for the sake of people listening. And the question this time is, what does Mary see and hear as she looks into the tomb, and what does she not see? So I'll read these verses, and you can be thinking about your answer to them. So Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." So, detectives, what does Mary see and hear as she looks into the tomb? Okay, what does she see and hear?
Two angels.
She sees two angels in white. And where are they sitting? One at the head and one at the feet. One at the head and one at the feet of where Jesus had been. What does she hear them saying? What did they say? Why are you crying? And what does she not see in the tomb?
The body.
She doesn't see the body. Right, let's ask another question. Okay, why? This time, the question is a why question and a who question. Okay, so the question is going to be, why does Mary Magdalene not recognize Jesus? So if I read verse 14 to you, first of all. At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. So why does she not recognize him? And who does she think she is speaking to? When you go on to read, it says, thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him. I'll go and get him." So first of all, use your intuition a little bit, okay? Why does she not recognize Jesus? So he's still bearing the marks of the beating and he's unrecognizable. Is that what you're saying, Wilf? Yeah? Yep. Okay. That could well be so. Don't forget, we don't know. This is perhaps reading things into the text that don't necessarily jump out. Why else would she not recognize him? Yeah. She didn't expect him, Harry says. And Ruth said,
"Yeah."
That's right. Have you ever gone into somewhere like Asda and bumped into, this is for the younger ones, seen your teacher in there and thought, why, what are they doing in here? They live in school. They couldn't possibly be normal people who go shopping. It's the wrong place for them to be. So this is, you're not expecting to see him. Maybe she'd been crying as well and she couldn't see through the tears. Who does she think she's talking to? The gardener. In what sense is she right? Here's a bit deeper. In what sense is she right?
That picture sometimes given of Jesus in sort of pruning branches and yeah. Being the gardener of life.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a picture, isn't it? For John 15, Jesus saying, I am the true vine, I'm the gardener, my Father is the gardener. So the sense that Jesus can prune our lives. So there's that to it as well. Let's ask another why question. Verses 16 and 17, which I'll read out to you at this point, and you can see the questions on the screen there. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me. I've not yet returned to the Father. Go and say to my brothers and tell them I'm returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." So the question is, why does John tell us that Mary cried out Rabboni in Aramaic? Come on, we're being detectives. We don't necessarily do this kind of thing all the time. Aramaic, the Bible is written in Greek, by the way. New Testament is written in Greek. So why does she cry out in Aramaic?
That might
be his language if he was a dog. Well, that's true. And it is their language, isn't it? That's the language they spoke. Although they could speak Greek. I can speak Scouse if I want to, but I don't do it very often. But my natural language is English. I'm a posh Scouser. Yes, I know I need to move sideways. I'll just keep moving backwards and forwards. I'm a bit of a wanderer. But Aramaic is her own language. And so when Jesus speaks to her, he doesn't sort of speak to her in formal Greek. He speaks to her in Aramaic. He says, Rabboni. If he'd been speaking Greek, it would have been Rabbi. But Rabboni is the Greek form. And he probably also speaks their name in that the Aramaic form, which would be Miriam rather than Mary. So it's very personal and very intimate. And why does Jesus tell Mary not to hold on to him? Let's not get hooked up on the Latin noli me tangere, do not touch me. It doesn't say that. That's the Latin translation, but it wasn't what the Greek said at all. Oh, he was in a bodily form, yes. She could hold him. She could grab him. In fact, she had grabbed him. Yeah. Have you never been grabbed by a youngster and he's got hold of your leg and you can't get him off and you're kicking him away like, get off my leg. She's holding on to him wherever he goes. She's not going to let go because she thought she'd lost him forever. But Jesus says, you don't need to hold on to me. You're going to see more of me. I'll be around for quite a while, yes, but I'm not yet ascended. Don't keep on holding on to me. There's another possibility also from the translation that it could have been, instead of me aptu, which is do not touch me, it could have been me patou, which means do not be afraid. And it could be that they transcribe that one slightly differently. But I think Jesus is really saying, do not hold on to me. So at this point, we are going to move on and listen to, it's quite a full program. We'll be over by 2. We'll be finished by 2 o'clock today. But we're now going to listen to a poem by a Welshman. I do love the lilting Welshness. I have a lot of Joneses going far back in my family. In fact, it's Joneses all the way, I think, on my mother's side. Joneses married Joneses. Here's a Welsh poem. Beautiful piece. I'm full because it was empty. Let's have a listen to this. This is brilliant.
I'm full because it was empty. Wind back the clock by a century and then times up by 20. You find yourself smack bang in the middle of a story filled with plenty. Plenty of drama, good for evil, social upheaval, and Pilate's Paul for the people. One word, popularity. And for clarity, treason sealed with a kiss gives reason to believe that this story seeps more plot twist than that Sixth Sense film with Bruce Willis. Now, main character, this guy, who weren't just guy, this guy was God. God's son, flesh and bones, breathe breath, there were a crown of thorns, but we'll get to that later. Let's address the fact there's this crater within us that needs a fill, and the climax happened up Golgotha Hill. Still, we'll get to that in just a minute. First, this guy. This guy was God, fully perfect, fully God. Protagonist of the greatest story ever told. See, this guy came to fulfill the promises of old, to fix up a relationship once broken, to be the fall guy, to become our sin payment talker. See, I'm full. I'm full because it was empty. I'm filled with life, life with plenty. I'm penalty paid, I'm free. But not just free, I'm full. I'm freely full and fully free. All because it was empty. Adam and Eve didn't believe and obey. They went the wrong way, disobeyed. A perfect relationship with Maker, frayed. Because it was empty, it's all changed. My path has been rerouted, remade, rearranged. See, this guy was God, bore mankind's weight of sin upon a tree, all to pay the penalty, lived, then died on a cross, all to pay the total cost, all to pay for my mistakes, but I get life. Guess that's called grace. And because he was afflicted, my burden of sin has been lifted, because he said, it is finished. Then, he took his last breath. Taken by death, he had died, and just in case, a spear rammed through his side. But a side note for you, I'm not going to believe what happens next. Laid in a tomb, his body so scarred, a boulder blocks the entrance and centurions on guard. Then 3 days later, death lost his hold, and this bit is gone. The grip of sin was over because the boulder had been rolled over. So now, forgiven and freely full and fully free, all cause it was empty.
Well, I hope you could hear that clearly. And if not, go back and look for that. I'm free because it was empty. It's a fabulous poem. We're now going to hear the third bit. We are going to run over by 10 minutes, so, you know, just filter that one into your thinking. And we're going to look at the passage from Luke 24. So you've got your third reading there in front of you. And again, we're going to listen to David Suchet reading this to us. This is the Emmaus story.
They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence.
When? Our first reading was early morning. Our second reading was morning. We're moving on now to the afternoon and the evening of that first Sunday. And three events in Scripture are told to us. First of all, Clopas or Cleopas and another disciple go to Emmaus, which is about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They recognize Jesus when he breaks bread with them at the house. They return to Jerusalem to tell the others. By this time, the disciples have come in from Bethany and are meeting now in John Mark's house, which is a very large house. Mark, who wrote the Gospel. And they're hiding behind closed doors for fear of the Jews, and Jesus appears to the disciples. That's the order of events. So detectives, once again, I'll have to put my hat back on. Here we go. And my magnifying glass. Last set of questions for you. First of all, let's ask a what or a how question. How do the disciples feel when they see Jesus? And for those who are listening, I'm going to read these verses. Verses 37 to 40, they were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." When he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" So what range of emotions are we dealing with here? There's quite a lot of them. Shout them out if you can from under your masks. Shocked, yes.
Joy.
Amazement. Say again.
Afraid,
yes.
Doubt.
All these raft of emotions are going on there. They're startled, they're frightened, they're troubled, they doubt, but there's joy and there's amazement and unbelief. Victor Meldrew had been there, he would have said, "I don't believe it." I found a fabulous cartoon, I haven't chosen to put it on, but it was a picture of an atheist turning up at the gates of heaven with a big sign up there sort of saying, "No atheists allowed in." And the atheist says, "I don't believe it." Which I thought was very funny as well, but there we are. Okay, let's have another question at this point. A what question? You're looking at a number of verses, and I'll read them for the sake of those listening in. Verses 36, 39, 41, and 42. What kind of body does Jesus have? So here we go. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you. Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." And then verses 41 and 42, he says, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish and he took it and ate it in their presence. Amazing, isn't it? The first thing the risen Lord has to eat is broiled fish. Not a burger, not anything really tasty, some broiled fish, whatever broiled fish is, I don't really know. It doesn't sound too tasty, but that's what he's given. What kind of a body does Jesus have?
Emaciated.
Emaciated? No, I don't think so. No, I don't think so. No. No. What kind of a body has he got?
Physical.
Yes, a physical body. Yeah, a physical body. How do we know that? Says what? Touch me. You can't touch a ghost, can you? And what else have we got?
Hungry.
He's hungry. Eat some food, broiled fish. And also, there's a really unusual phrase in there which people have made a lot of. What's he composed of? What does his body comprise?
Flesh and
any mention of blood? Just bones? Flesh and bones? Maybe the new resurrection body doesn't have blood in it. I don't know. People have written treatises on that, whole treatises. I think that's really interesting. That's the kind of thing that would interest me, I guess. Finally, last question for you. Question 9, verses 33 to 43, which I'm not reading. What does this passage reveal about the risen Christ? What do you think it tells you? And shout them out, and then we're done on our questions. It's normal, okay? But is he the same as he was before he died? No. You see, I'd have to take issue with the idea of him being emaciated, because that would suggest that he was some kind of terrible, crushed, broken sort of person. But I think he rises as the he rises as the Lord of life. He's full of life. What can his body do that it couldn't do before? Yeah, move through walls, pass in and out of walls, appear and reappear. Sometimes they recognize him, sometimes they don't. But it's really important that Christians get a hold on this fact that he came back in a risen body. It was a real physical body. Wasn't some kind of mystical experience, because we're promised as Christians that we too one day will share in this glorious resurrection body that he has too. So we're going to listen to a piece of music at this point, last about 5 minutes. So I think we're going to be running until about 15:15, and I'm sorry we've run over a fair bit, but I'm sure your Easter lamb will wait. Let's listen to this, Man of Sorrows.
Salvation, where your love poured out over me. is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, salvation, where your love poured out over me, yeah. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. See the stone.
One last question, the importance of 10. What really happened at the tomb? These are questions you need to take away with you and think about. What really happened at the tomb? And secondly, why does it matter? The third question would be, who is Jesus? I then want to ask you, where do you stand in relation to Jesus? Is he your Lord and Savior, or is he an interesting character from history, or somebody you're exploring? Where do you stand? And how do I respond if I've never responded, you know, that never responded to the love? Jesus died so that we could have forgiveness and be part of God's family. And all we need to do is say sorry and thank you and become part of his family as we confess our sins. And finally, I'd want to be asking the question, when can I go home for lunch? Because I couldn't think of a when question, but there we are. Tom Wright says, ask most people around the world what they think is the biggest day for Christians. Most will say Christmas. The true answer, and I wish churches had find ways of making this clear, is Easter. This is the moment of new creation. If it hadn't been for Easter, nobody would have ever have dreamed of celebrating Christmas. This is the first day of God's new week. Sunday was the last day of the week of the old creation. It was the seventh day. But now it's the first day of the week. The darkness has gone and the sun is shining. So I'm going to pray with you. And at the opening of this prayer, I'm going to read some words from Elizabeth Rooney. Now is the shining fabric of our day torn open, flung apart, rent wide by love. Never again the tight enclosing sky, the blue bowl or the star-illumined tent. We are laid open to infinity. For Easter love has burst his tomb and ours. Now nothing shelters us from God's desire, not flesh, nor sky, nor stars, not even sin. Now glory waits so he can enter in. Now does the dance begin. Father God, we thank you that when they went to look at the dead body of the Lord Jesus, he just wasn't there. He had risen as though he'd passed like through a chrysalis and come back to life again. And thank you that it wasn't just an idea, a spiritual idea of resurrection. There was a real body, but a body that was totally different as well, Lord. Recognizable and yet unrecognizable and completely different, Lord. Thank you for the promise that we too will share in that bodily, glorious resurrection, that Jesus is just the first fruits of all that has been promised. And as we celebrate resurrection on this glorious Easter Sunday, help us to be thankful, Lord, once again for your love towards us, and help us to share that with others in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So if you want to explore that further, the last time I looked, there were three new on Amazon for $14.48 of the John Wenham one with a slightly different picture to it. Of course, if you want to buy, down she goes, if you want to buy Thucydides' Peloponnesian War, you can do that as well, but I wouldn't recommend that quite so much. Let's have a quick look. I don't know whether we've ended our service at this point. Probably have. But let's have a look at any...